I still see the logo.
He said he's, Paul said he can't see it yet. I'm sorry? Oh, okay, so Paul's only gonna see the logo. Y'all see my picture? Okay. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, yeah, right. They don't want me up here. I'm sorry. How was your sound, Sam? No. Right. So I can move now? Okay, Paul, so they're gonna keep the logo up. And I don't know, is it 5 minutes till we take the logo down? I'm asking the question. Hmm? 5 minutes. Okay, so Paul, that's 5 minutes up.
Good day and welcome to the July Commission Business Meeting. Today's conference is being recorded. At this time, I'd like to turn the conference over to Staff Director Mara Morales. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Welcome to the business meeting for the U.S. Commission on Civil Rights. The meeting comes to order at 12:27 Eastern Standard Time on Friday, July 21st, 2023. I am Staff Director Mauro Morales. I'm not substantively participating in this meeting, but because of the current absence of a chair and a vice chair, I am administering pursuant to my administrative functions. I would like to confirm the commissioners that are present, and I'll take a roll call. Please say present when I say your name. Commissioner Adams.
Present.
Commissioner Garza.
Present.
Commissioner Gilchrist.
Present.
Commissioner Harriet.
I'm here.
Commissioner Jones.
Present.
Commissioner Kersenow.
Here.
Commissioner Magpontai.
Here.
Commissioner Nourse.
Present.
Based on the responses, a quorum of commissioners is present. Is the court reporter present?
I'm here.
Thank you. The meeting will now come to order. Commissioners have been informed that only one item was created for the agenda, and it would be the president's request to designate a chair and a vice chair for the commissioners. Commissioners have further been informed that the proper procedure is to amend a current agenda as established by commission rules, and commissioners can make a motion to change the agenda by a majority vote. Do any commissioners have amendments to the agenda?
I move to adopt the agenda.
I second.
I second.
Any objections?
I move to amend the agenda. I move to include, first, a vote jointly on the crime victims package of documents and the confirmation of the nominations for chair and vice chair, at which time Commissioners Garza and Nourse will make an on-the-record statement regarding our 30-30-10 policy. And second, a vote on the report titled The Federal Response to Anti-Asian Racism. And third, a vote on findings and recommendations for the same report, the federal response to anti-Asian racism. This would obviate the need to vote to confirm the chair and vice chair as a separate item.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any objections? None. Are there additional motions?
Are you moving as this happening?
No, we have to vote.
We did. There were no objections.
Okay. We have to vote on the motion to amend.
There's
now.
I
call the question on the motion to amend.
Okay. How do you vote?
I bet we can take an oral one on that, and then just a group vote.
I thought I did, but okay. Are there any? All in favor to say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any objections?
Now we need to vote
hearing
on
none.
The main motion.
I'm sorry. Hearing none, we can then proceed. Please, Commissioner Harriet.
No, we now have to vote on the main motion, which was Pete's motion to adopt the agenda.
Okay. Any all in favor, say aye.
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 Any objections? Hearing none, please proceed. Commissioner Kirstenow. Commissioner Harriet.
I have a motion.
Okay, please proceed.
I move that the package of documents negotiated among Commissioners Garza, Nourse, Harriet, and Kersenow, and distributed by email by Commissioner Garza at 11:38 a.m. today, be adopted as a commission project with a briefing in 2023 and a report to be published in September 2024, and to confirm Commissioner Rochelle Garza as chair of the commission and Commissioner Victoria Nourse as vice chair of the commission.
Second.
I'll take a vote, correct?
Nope. I would like to turn to Commissioner Garza that has a statement to make, I think.
I think we're in discussion, in the discussion portion. So I know this has taken quite a bit of time to get here. I'm very pleased that we could come to an agreement I'm very pleased. I'm very excited about the work that we're going to do together moving forward. I think that this commission is critically important for civil rights in this country. I deeply believe in civil rights. I think my first meeting, I talked about my grandmother and how much was accomplished through her and how I stand on her shoulders to be in a place like this. So I take this very, very seriously. And I'm deeply honored to have been nominated for the position and to have been able to come to an agreement with my colleagues on the other side. And I obviously accept the nomination. I accept the role of being chair. I do want to just be very brief on what we've agreed to. We found agreement on the crime victims discovery plan that the Republican caucus has put forward. And we also have come to an understanding on how we're going to work together moving forward, including, a 30-30-10 process for statements, rebuttals, and server rebuttals on reports, and also in terms of working together on findings and recommendations moving forward. And I'll allow others to step in on that issue.
Any additional?
You're going to read the statement?
Yes, I'd like to read this statement. I want to concur in what Commissioner Garza said. It's a great honor to be nominated by the president. It's a great honor for me personally to be Commissioner Garza's VEEP. So, memorandum of understanding. Commissioners have the right to contribute written statements to commission reports. This longstanding practice was formally adopted by the commission in a business meeting on November 19, 2010. This policy provides that from the date of the adoption of a commission report, commissioners have 30 days in which to submit a written statement that will accompany a report. After the staff director distributes the written statements, commissioners have 30 days in which to submit a rebuttal. If three commissioners agree that surrebuttal is warranted, there will be a 10-day surrebuttal period. If commissioners wish to invoke surrebuttal, they will notify the staff director of their intention to invoke the surrebuttal period no more than 3 days after the rebuttals are distributed. For all of you, what this just means is normal federal court practice. We pledge to always vote with our colleagues to uphold this commission statement, this particular statement, and the rebuttal and surrebuttal policy. I'm speaking for Commissioner Garza. If she disagrees, she can state it for the record. I believe we both agree that we will affirmatively vote against any attempt to truncate the timelines. We will only vote to truncate the timeline for a particular report if all commissioners plan to write statements, rebuttals, and surrebuttals agree to truncating the timeline, which does happen on occasion. Thank you.
Any further?
You're going to say that you agree.
There's no disagreement for me on this. I, as I said in my opening statement, that we worked very hard over the last 3 months to come to an agreement here, and I am a person of my word. So I obviously agree with everything that we have agreed to. And just to give you all the opportunity with regards to the findings and recommendations that we had discussed.
Yes, during our negotiations, we agreed that we would try very hard to come up with findings and recommendations for our reports. We, of course, cannot, guarantee that we will agree, but we want to have a procedure in place that will allow us to be thinking about that and trying to reach agreement where we can for each report.
And that procedure includes at least having two commissioners from each caucus work together, with enough time to make sure that we can include findings and recommendations in our reports.
Yes, I think that's a good idea, and I think I'd like to see that committee formed at the time that the first draft of the report comes out.
Okay.
Any further comments?
Yeah, I would just like to extend my gratitude and appreciation to all the commissioners, but particularly Commissioner and Chair nominee Garza and Vice Chair Nourse. This has been a collegial process. We've come to an agreement. I hope this portends for the future on the commission. It hasn't always been thus, but this is a great start, and I look forward to working with everybody here.
I appreciate that. Genuinely, I think you know, I'm someone that always tries to find some middle ground, and I appreciate the fact that we were able to do that, and I appreciate the efforts that you all made. I'm proud of what we did to get to this point, and I'm really looking forward to what we're going to do moving forward. And you have my commitment to work with you, always. So, I called the question.
Let me call the question on your behalf here.
Yes. Oh, sorry. If you would like to do it.
I would like to do that. So,
okay.
So.
Please, Commissioner Harriet.
I'm just calling the question.
Call the question. Gotcha. I just wanted to clarify.
Let's get these ladies installed here.
Sure. Let's have a vote on their your motion to move the package of documents negotiated by Commissioners Garza, Nourse, Harriet, Kersenow, and distributed by email with Commissioner Garza at 11:38 to be adopted as a commission project with the briefing in 2023 and a report to be published in September of 2024, and to confirm Commissioner Rochelle Garza as chair and Commissioner Victoria Nourse as vice chair. I will take a roll call vote. Commissioner Adams, how do you vote?
Aye.
Commissioner Garza, how do you vote?
Yes.
Commissioner Gilchrist, how do you vote?
Absolutely yes.
With that, Commissioner Harriet, how do you vote?
Yes.
Commissioner Jones, how do you vote? Commissioner Kersenow, how do you vote?
Emphatically, yes.
Commissioner Magapentai?
Aye.
Commissioner Nourse?
Aye.
Well, congratulations, Chair Garza and Vice Chair Nourse. I turn the gavel over to you.
Thank you, Staff Director Morales. Okay, for our... for our second order of business, we turn to discussion and vote on the 2023 statutory enforcement report, the federal response to anti-Asian racism in the United States. The version that we will be voting on was shared by Special Assistant Irena Vidlovic. I'm sorry. On Thursday, July 20th at 2:39 p.m. That same version was also uploaded to the commissioner's folder. I'll open up the floor for discussion.
Do you need a motion to?
I believe that it was already moved on in our omnibus.
Yeah. No, that's this is a separate motion.
No, he needs to move it.
Oh, yes. I apologize.
Move I move for adoption.
I second the motion.
Is there a discussion on this?
I would just to say one thing, that this may be one of the first or second reports that we have ever done with regard to the Asian community. So I think that's a sign of progress, that we are moving forward here, despite the delays in getting us all installed. So
it is the second. I think that maybe not even that. I'm not certain. But it's not the first.
Okay. Yeah, no, I believe it is the second. The first report was civil rights issues facing Asian Americans in the 1990s. And so I'm very proud of the support. There was a lot of work. I thank the staff for their diligence and their efforts and tolerance with all the changes and edits.
Tolerance.
Thank you. And accommodation. I think it says some great things. This is important for our community. This is important for America. It's a great report.
Yeah, and just some thoughts. I mean, that was my first, the first meeting I attended for USCCR, and just I was incredibly touched by the individuals that came to speak about their experiences. I think it's critically important that we memorialize what has happened in the wake of COVID-19, specifically with the Asian American community experiencing these kinds of discrimination and issues and hate crimes. You know, obviously the report identifies room for improvement when it comes to reporting and having systems in place to capture what is happening. And I look forward to our report at least memorializing all of this and creating the space for additional research and additional improvements to the system so that we can protect people's civil rights moving forward. If there's nothing further, we can call to to question. Okay. Well, I have one additional thing. I just would like to thank the staff for all the work that you all put into that report, into putting together the event. Merrick, specifically, thank you for all that work. I think, we obviously wouldn't be able to do it without you. So thank you very much for all of your efforts.
I concur.
Okay, let's call to question then. Can I do that?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Commissioner Adams, how do you vote?
Yes.
Commissioner Garza, that's myself, yes. Commissioner Gilchrist?
Yes.
Commissioner Harriet?
I'm going to abstain.
Commissioner Jones?
Yes.
Commissioner Kersenow?
Abstain.
Commissioner Magpentai?
Aye.
Commissioner Nurse?
Aye.
The vote passes with two abstentions. Six yeas and 12?
And two abstentions.
Okay, six yeas and two abstentions. So the vote passes. The report should be adopted.
Madam Chair, may I move for adoption of the findings and recommendations that was distributed to the commissioners via email on Wednesday, 9:10 a.m.? And that's in the commissioner's folder.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Gilchrist. Is there any discussion? I'm sorry, Commissioner Adams. Any discussion?
We're talking about the long list here.
Yes. So since I made the motion, I just want to read some of the findings and recommendations that we found out from this work. This will take a minute. So the findings that we find around data collection and reporting, a major impediment to understanding the severity and magnitude of hate crimes against persons of Asian descent is the lack of comprehensive data. Hate crimes victims are often likely to report incidents due to fear, retaliation, concerns that justice will not be served, and distrust of the criminal justice system. In March 2023, the FBI released Supplemental Hate Crime Statistics Report and showed that a number of anti-Asian incidents increased 167% from 2,079 in 2020 to 740 in 2021. National data shows that all race-based hate crimes rose by 30% in 2020, and specifically anti-Asian hate crimes increased over 70% in 2020. Hate crimes data are underreported by victims and by law enforcement and are less likely to be reported to police compared to other types of crimes. And some research suggests that Asian Americans have been even less likely to report discriminatory behavior when it occurs. In the United States, 34% of the Asian American population is limited English proficient. The most frequently spoken languages are Chinese, Korean, Vietnamese, Tagalog, Thai, Khmer, Bengali, Gujarati, Hindi, and Punjabi. What are the barriers? Few police departments have offices fluent in Asian languages, even in metropolitan areas with high numbers of AAPI residents. Therefore, the language barriers continue to be a major barrier to reporting hate crimes and hate incidents and hate harassment. Under the COVID-19 Hate Crimes Act, passed by Congress, funding is provided for state and local independent reporting hotlines. However, the commission's briefing panelists testified that local reporting hotlines, victim services, and law enforcement were not accessible to victims with limited English proficiency. And we heard moving testimony about this. The lack of hate crimes prosecutions may also be a contributing factor to low reporting of hate crimes. Prosecution of hate crimes is difficult, even in states with comprehensive hate crimes legislation, because there is no one legal standard to which courts have agreed, or because the standard to prove bias is too high. So some recommendations that we tease out from the report. Data and reporting. The FBI should require local law enforcement to submit crime data. DOJ should fund local and state government efforts in partnership with community-based organizations to address discrimination and other incidents of hate. Law enforcement agencies should improve data collection, recommendations and trainings and partnerships. The Justice Department should provide safety trainings and workshops in the respective languages of targeted communities and expand federal funding for community advocacy groups fighting hate crimes. The Justice Department should codify the role of language access coordinator into federal law to ensure that all individuals have access to justice and access to federal programs and benefits regardless of language access. A written policy with law enforcement organizations can serve as a bridge between hate crimes legislation and implementation of that law by providing officers with information and a standard that the agency expects them to follow. Prosecutors and law enforcement should engage in joint trainings on hate crimes and community engagement, and law enforcement agencies may even consider recommending that the prosecutor's office have a designated attorney to prosecute hate crimes in the community. And prosecutors and law enforcement should vigorously investigate and prosecute hate crimes and harassment against Asian Americans. A public health and gender-based focus approach to prevent hate crimes in public spaces needs to be increased, including the street harassment of AAPI women and other vulnerable communities. The strengthening of local networks should be investigated so individuals have ready access to community-based places where they can report attacks, receive support services, and take safety training and workshops in their own languages. Language access. We're almost there. Language access. Reporting language access. Regarding language access, federal agencies need to review their compliance with Title VI of Federal Executive Order 13166 and take appropriate steps to address any potential violations to ensure that they provide language access to services to individuals who need them. The recipients of federal funding, local law enforcement, and victim services should comply with Title VI of an Executive Order 13166, provide language access such as interpreters and bilingual officers who speak Asian languages. Federal agencies need to identify critical deficiencies in limited English proficient programs for individuals who need language assistance and expand reporting hotlines or in-person contact for those with limited English proficiency. Those were some of the major highlights of the findings and recommendations in the list that was circulated to the commissioners. Thank you.
Is there anyone else that has any other comments or discussion on this point?
Madam Chair.
Yes.
This is a motion to amend, and I'm going to be a little specific for the court reporter so the staff can look through the record, should this motion pass, to do probably what we're trying to do. I would move to amend the very earnest and thoughtful recommendations listed by Commissioner Magpentai, and I would move to amend his motion, and the reason is because I think there's a good chance that some recommendations and findings can pass, and I think there's a good chance on the other side of the coin that no findings or recommendations could pass. And I would move to amend his list, which we've all gotten, and hopefully will be attached for the court reporter somewhere in the record, and to make his list become five findings or recommendations. And I'm going to list them, and there's also a number I'll have for the court reporter to catch and staff to look at the record to figure this out. So the first one, which Commissioner Magpentai's bullet sheet list would be the fourth bullet point. Now, the list doesn't have numbers, but it is the fourth bullet point. And that is, quote, "A major impediment to understanding the severity and magnitude of hate crimes against persons of Asian descent is a lack of comprehensive data." My motion is to include that one. There's four more. The next one is bullet point number six, and that says the transition to all the NIBRS data collection has been slow for some agencies. For for 2021. The number of participating agencies within the FBI hate crimes database was 11,834, compared to the 15,138 participating agencies for 2020 data, and many of the agencies that have not submitted 2021 are the largest jurisdictions. So my motion to amend also includes that finding and recommendation. There's three more. The next is bullet point number 29. Prosecutors and law enforcement should vigorously investigate and prosecute hate crimes against all Americans. My motion to amend includes number 29. The fourth one. First responders should be provided with training aimed at teaching a clear understanding of what constitutes a hate crime in their jurisdiction. On Commissioner Magpentai's document, that is bullet point number 30. And Yankee Doodle. I don't know where that's coming. We heard a cat earlier, I guess. Okay. Okay, last one. Five. This is the fifth one. Now, Commissioner Magpentai's list, it's bullet 36, bullet number 36. And it says federal agencies and law enforcement need to identify critical deficiencies in limited English proficient LEP programs for individuals who need language assistance. That's number 36 on Commissioner Magpentai's list. I would move to amend his list to be replaced with these five bullet points.
We have a motion. Do we have a second? Motion to amend. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second.
Discussion?
Discussion.
Okay. As we've seen the last three or four months, it's pretty hard to get five votes around here. My amendment is designed to get five votes for some findings and recommendations. That's the purpose of the amendment. I think these are good findings and recommendations, and I think this will mean that there will be some findings and recommendations. That's all I have.
Any further discussion? Called a question?
On the amendment?
On your amendment? Okay. Commissioner Adams, how do you vote?
Yes.
Commissioner Garza, yes. Commissioner Gilchrist?
Yes.
Commissioner Harriet?
I just want to clarify, this is a motion to amend. This is not the final motion on this actual thing. I can vote in favor of the motion to amend.
Okay. Yes for Commissioner Harriet. Commissioner Jones?
Yes.
Commissioner Kersenow?
Yes.
Commissioner Magapentai?
A tolerant yes.
Noted. Commissioner Nourse?
Aye.
Okay, motion passes unanimously. Is there any then we go back to the original. Okay. Sorry. Do we want to call? Sorry?
Discussion.
Discussion.
Is there discussion on this issue?
Yeah.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I think that Commissioner Magpentai's list that we've amended has some really important things. And I know when I was an attorney at the Civil Rights Division, the Justice Department, that having limited English proficient people in place and important offices that contact the public is the difference between bewilderment and protection. And a lot of times when they didn't speak the language, it was bewilderment. And when they did, it was they were protected. And so I think there's some really good ideas here. Clearly, we need to prosecute and investigate hate crimes, maybe not in that order. I suppose investigate and prosecute is better. And first responders, I mean, we heard testimony at the hearing where hate crimes die on the vine at the beginning as far as prosecutions go, because there's no one who understands what happened when a first responder shows up. So I think there's some really good ideas in this, and that's why I support the passage to include these findings and recommendations.
Any further discussion?
In a spirit of concurrence, I will just say, I think that Commissioner Adams is absolutely correct. Having worked on hate crimes issues for many years, the identification of a hate crime itself is very difficult, and unless first responders are capable of distinguishing between that which is and which is not, and they must investigate, not simply look for some kind of statement, because that's not what makes a hate crime. So I, too, was moved by that testimony from the hate crimes coordinator in Los Angeles at our first hearing, and I think that's a very important recommendation and finding of the commission.
Commissioner Mike Pentendai?
Yeah, no, I support these 5 points in principle. I think they're good. I still think that our findings and recommendations should be more robust. But in the spirit of finding common ground and areas of agreement, I get it, and I support these items. I also do want to note that around language access, and for the record, we are not saying translate everything to like the 300 languages across the world in all of America. I want to be very clear that there is a federal standard which is articulated under Executive Order 13166, which looks at the numbers of limited English proficient people in an area with the rates of English proficiency. And so we're not looking at encapsulating and covering every language for everyone at every moment. That would be great. I would support that too, but that might be a strain on resources. There is a prioritization to look at the populations who most need the services, who are numerous in numbers and do not speak English or English well. And so these recommendations would go towards that and to advancing that. And we have a good report and a good briefing that actually supports these findings and recommendations.
Madam Chair. Commissioner Jones.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Feels really good to call you that. I just want to thank my colleague, Glenn, for just his incredible work on finding areas of common ground with our Republican colleagues on these findings and recommendations. I, too, want to go on the record as expressing my disappointment that we could not reach agreement on a much more comprehensive set of what I view to be non-controversial findings and recommendations. But in the interest of comedy and moving forward the work of this commission, of course, I'm going to vote for what we were able to agree on with our Republican colleagues. I will tell you, as someone who was very proud to vote for hate crimes legislation that became law during COVID to protect the Asian American community here in the United States, that this is something that is very important to me. It has been far too long that the AAPI community in this country has not gotten the attention that it deserves when it comes to these crimes and other incidents of hate, which maybe don't meet the definition of crimes, but certainly have devastating impacts on the AAPI community. And I'm glad that we're taking a step forward today.
I would like to add as well that I wish we could incorporate more robust findings and recommendations. However, I, in the spirit of compromise, in the spirit of finding something that we can put in the official record in the report, I'm going to be voting in favor of this. Is there any other discussion?
Madam Chair. Okay. I just want to put on the record that I'm very pleased that my colleagues have come to some agreement. I'm going to have to abstain on these, but I am very confident that with the new procedures that we're going to be putting in for findings and recs, that we'll be able to do an even better job next time. And that there are things on this list I could easily agree to, but I'll spare you the details of which parts I have problems with.
Okay. Well, I appreciate the encouragement that we're going to be able to work together moving forward on that. Is there any further discussion on this before we call to question? Yeah, Commissioner McPentire?
To be transparent, this is a personal issue for me. I had worked on the Federal Hate Crimes Act, on hate crime statistics, since 1988. And, in full disclosure, I am the survivor of a hate crime for being gay from 20 years ago, and I'm the victim of a hate crime for being Asian from 20 months ago. So I sit on this commission having lived this experience as well. I think it informs what I see that's on the ground and why I'm so happy and grateful for this report and these recommendations. They will mean a lot. They will make a tremendous impact on the communities, that need the support. And I'm a lawyer, and I'm a victim of a hate crime. You can imagine what the non-lawyers are trying to deal with. I mean, I can deal with my case. So thank you for the support and for moving these issues forward.
And thank you for sharing that, Glenn. Commissioner Nourse?
I just want to thank Commissioner Meg Pente for sharing that, because that's often kind of difficult for those of us who are lawyers. And I want to thank Commissioner Adams for his comedy on trying to come to some agreement on this. Thank you.
Wonderful. With no further discussion, we can vote on the motion as amended to include the items that Commissioner Adams identified. We can start with Commissioner Adams. How do you vote?
Aye.
I vote yes. Commissioner Gilchrist?
Aye.
Commissioner Harriet?
I abstain.
Commissioner Jones?
Aye.
Commissioner Kersnow?
Yes.
Commissioner Magapintai?
Aye.
Commissioner Nourse?
Aye.
Wonderful. We have seven yeses and one abstention. So we have findings and recommendations.
All right. Thank you.
Great.
And you just conducted your first meeting. So
yes,
congratulations.
I did. Thank you all for your patience. It will get better. I'm going to take a point of privilege here and just say thank you to the staff for all of your support and in bending over backwards and answering a million questions a million times from all of us. We really genuinely appreciate all that you've done to help us get to this point. I'm very encouraged. I am an optimist through and through. I'm also pragmatic, but you know, I'm very optimistic about where we're going as a commission. And I just want to say thank you also, a big thank you to the staff director, Mauro Morales, for really, for his leadership and for the support that he has obviously provided the staff and support he's provided to this commission as a whole in helping us get on track. And I look forward to moving us forward, but I do want to say a big thank you to you.
Thank you very much. If I might just take a quick minute. Normally we have an opportunity to do the staff director's report. I usually don't do it because all the information is contained in the report. And if you have any specific questions, please see me. I don't want to take up additional time. But I would like to just as a reminder to all commissioners, special assistants, and of course the staff, that the offices are being closed on Monday for renovation. You won't have access to the offices. They're going to put in some new carpet, painting. They're going to actually create a couple more extra offices since we're adding some staff. So they'll reopen on August 14th. But if you have any questions, please see Pam Dunstan. She will let you know whatever it is you might, answering your questions, or let you know what you need to know. And also, please, commissioners, look for an email about our interns that served this summer. I didn't get a chance. Normally we bring them forward and, you know, thank them for, and some of them are here and some of them aren't, but I want to make sure that they all get recognized. Some of them are interns for commissioners, some are for the different departments. So I want to make sure we do that as we start getting towards the close of the summer. And then finally, I just want to thank the staff. I mean, this has been an interesting time, but everybody's hung together and worked together as a team, and I'm so proud of you all. And congratulations, Chair Garza and Vice Chair Nourse. We look forward to working with you. And I speak on behalf of the staff. We're all looking forward to helping you do your jobs. And all the commissioners, of course, at any time we're available to help. And the General Counsel's office and everybody else. So thank you very much.
Madam Chair, just if you'll indulge me just for a quick
yes,
second.
Yes, of course, Commissioner Jones.
I also want to give a huge thank you to my confidential assistant, my special assistant, Irina Vitalovic, who has done a lot of incredible work on behalf of the Democratic commissioners on this body as we wait for the White House to finally move forward the process to get other special assistants approved. I mean, she has really responded to so many of us and been incredibly helpful at moving the ball forward. So I just want to highlight her important work.
Irina is indispensable, and I forgive me for the oversight. You know, most of us are new, and we haven't had a special assistant for most of this time, and Irina has kind of carried the team and carried the work. So I genuinely appreciate her, but I also want to say thank you to my colleagues as well for being supportive. I feel like this is a good moment because I feel like this can set the tone for what this is going to look like moving forward. And I'm like I said, I am truly an optimist, and I feel like we can always find agreement. And I look forward to what we can do as a commission and what we can do together. So, Commissioner Magapintai.
So, with the staff director's report, I did read it, and I look, you know, I want to actually commend the state advisory committees, the SACs, for what they did. I actually had an opportunity to meet with David Musat in Chicago, and also Romana Lee Klein from the Pennsylvania State Advisory Committee invited me to a meeting, so I had an opportunity to listen in on their meeting, and they're issuing a wonderful report. The State Advisory Committees, I think, do really great work. They advise this commission. They look at issues that maybe are more state and local focus than we would look at the federal and national level, but I really want to applaud them. And again, I want to recognize David on the record for his good work and all the staff in Chicago. I know Chicago's a little far away, and there, if you're watching, thank you for what you do and for your service, and to all the state advisory committees, thank you for your service.
Yeah, Commissioner Adams.
Point of, I guess it's parliamentary inquiry. We had some discussion about a conflict somebody had with an August meeting date, I thought.
Yes.
Are we? Is that on the agenda to take up, or that's, so it's parliamentary inquiry. Are we going to take up that problem somebody had?
I mean, we could do it by notational vote.
Okay.
If there is no opposition, we can just do that. Unless you all are in agreement.
I would motion to cancel the August meeting due
Second.
To conflicting schedules.
Second.
I will take that under advisement, I think, is my understanding how this works.
I think we should kind of survey all the commissioners. It's probably the right direction to go, but I don't know that everybody has had an opportunity to win.
There's somebody who...
Go ahead. Sorry.
My staff just informs me the decision's already been made. Apparently, I didn't know that it's canceled.
No. There's,
I'm sorry.
No. There's been no decision. I move that we go ahead and table this and that we can resolve it via email. I think we could do a notational vote on that.
Well, I think we'd also have 5 votes to cancel it here. So...
No, we don't vote.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
We don't need a vote to cancel.
Okay. All right,
there's an open motion right now that was seconded.
I'll withdraw.
Glenn has withdrawn his motion.
Okay.
Glenn has withdrawn. Okay. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you so much.
Good job.
We're going to take a photograph out front with the new chair, please.
Been there, done that.
Commissioners.
Yes. It's all right. You did great. It'll get better. You did great.
No.
Hi.
Thank you.